Reuven asked Shimon to purchase for him a lottery ticket. Shimon went and he purchased the lottery ticket from his own money. It turns that he purchased more than one ticket. One of those tickets won. Shimon wanted to deposit the ticket and get the money. Reuven said, give it to me. Shimon said, I used my money and I bought the ticket for myself. Reuven said, if you lose for all these three tickets, or even one, you will come back to me and you ask for the money. Reuven insisted that he wants to have the entire amount of the winning. Shimon insisted that he wants to have the entire amount of money. The question we're going to discuss is the subject of shlichut, an emissary, such as a sensitive subject of widow and orphans, especially if the orphans are from different wives, how and what you treat it. So today we're going to study page 99. We start on page 98b, seven lines from the bottom of the page. Tashma hayta ketubta mane. So first, just to refresh of yesterday, Reuven, just using name, Reuven, he sent Shimon and he said to him, you will be my shaliach, my emissary, to sell 15 se'ah. Se'ah for our discussion is just a measurement. Shimon went ahead and he sold 30, which means it was a potential in the, for example, in the storehouse for more, and he sold double to what Reuven asked him to sell. So then the buyer discovered that Reuven wanted to sell only 15, not 30. So the big question is Shimon Mecher, is Shimon manner of transaction, of sale, is effective? Because he did not follow strictly the way that Reuven instructed him. Reuven told him to sell 15. So you tell me that the entire shlichut, the entire mission, is totally void? Or you say that his portion, which means 15, is in effect, and not the rest? Because imagine a situation. Reuven said it's all void. Shimon said, you asked me to sell 15. I did sell 30, but 15, I for sure. Levi, who was the buyer, insisted, I don't mind to negotiate or return the 15. By 15, you agreed to sell, because that's what Shimon sell me, so that's already effective act. Reuven said, no, since he didn't follow strictly the way I instructed him, everything is void. So here, we try to prove, and in a way, in a juxtaposition, a similar situation. Here's the widow. Hayta ketubta mane. If the ketubah was 100, umachra shave mane, vedinar bemane, michra batel. So guess what? She had the marriage contract worth of 100 dinars. And she sold property worth with 100 dinars and dinar. The idea is it was not the exact amount. For 100 dinars, the sale is void. Why? Because as we said, it's not the way it's supposed to be. And we are very scrupulous in the exactness of matter. So even she said, you know what, I'll pull out one dinar and I'm going to give it to the heir. It still, since it was not strictly the way it was instructed, in this case we say that it's void. My love, you mean to say that the Mishnah speaks about what? Dezabin shave mane vedinar bemane vedinar. You mean to say that she sold a property worth 100 dinars and a dinar for 100 dinars and a dinar. So it means that it was not mistake in a sale, it was a real amount of worthness. My bemane. So what exactly the Tana meant when she sold the estate for 100? You have to say mane shela. I explain in my book. Rashi here said klomar bishvil mane shehaya lo litkabel machra shave dinar vedinar beshovyo. So here I elaborate a lot based on the book called Hafla'a, but the idea is that mane, it's not the kesef tmura, the money that she received for the sale. It means the reason for the sale, which means the mane for that context is figurative, is not literative. That's what I think what Rashi meant, that since she deserved in her ketubah 100, so therefore that's solely and only she deserved, and since she adds one dinar from the orphans, so therefore it's total different frame of work of sale. So again, I elaborate on that in my book, you're welcome to read, and also in the book called Hafla'a. So they said, ulemai afilu. So what did the Mishnah meant to say afilu? Afilu, he omeret, even if she said, achazir et hadinar layorshim, bedinar mekarkei, I'll return the one extra dinar to the heirs. But it's still, we said that it's not a sale. Vekatane micha batel, and we learn that the sale is void, which means that it's not just she had void, but the entire sale void. So now we try to juxtapose this to our early question in regard to shaliach, to emissary. Meaning, if you have a shaliach, an emissary, that sold 30 kur instead of 15. You remember that? So it's considering ma'avir al dvarav shel ba'al habayit, which means you are in violation of what the one who sent you asked you to do. So it's not just mosif al dvarav, it's ma'avir al dvarav. What does that mean? You take a stock broker, yesterday we said, and you tell him, here's a $5,000, buy for me GM stocks. And he bought for you GE stocks. So the question you have to ask when you examine is just, is a hearings issue? Is just a normal human error? Or it was surreptitiously, clandestinely made by the broker a malicious decision or personal decisions that really ignore your requests, especially in the cases that there is disputation over getting less the amount. But even you get more, it's the question, is that considering adding to his request? The person is away and you actually, you know, brokers, sometimes they call you and convince you that it's a mistake and you should buy something else. Or you say that it's total ma'avir al dvarav. You really violated what you asked to do, and therefore the sale is total void. And we try to bring from this sugya, from the widow, a source for that. Amar Rav Huna Breide Rav Natan, lo! That's not the meaning of the Mishnah. The Mishnah speaking about what? Be de ozil, when she reduced the price. So it means that she sold something that is 101 dinar for 100. So therefore, the sale is void. Why? Because the orphan lost potential income when she sold this estate in a cheap price. There is a concept we learned many times. Rabbi Akiva Iger elaborates on that. and it's called letakunei shdartich velo leavutei, meaning I sent you to quote unquote ameliorate, repair the situation, not to deteriorate the situation, which means if emissary went ahead and did something that deteriorated what the one who sent him asked him to do, so he's no longer considered a true shaliach, a true emissary. But if she sold more, which means 100 dinar by 100 dinar, maybe you say that it's not annulled. Why? Because it's not considering ivut, it's not considering deterioration. The condition the Meiri said and others that she must return that dinar to the orphan. So the big question that is a discussion, the Rabbi Akiva Iger and others, is how exactly you go about when you have someone who is your agent, who is your power of attorney. How far you go with that? Because the reality of life you see in every avenue. You can start with a real estate broker, continue with a stock broker, and you continue even with your attorney. That sometimes you ask to do something, and they are doing something, and you feel they are really not represent what I asked them to do. And then you go after them and you said, look what you did. That's absolutely not what I ask you to do. You make it even worse. Or even you improve, or you did something better, that's not what I ask you to do. Page 99, the Gemara asks a question. Ha mid de seifa bid de ozir. The last clause of the Mishnah, the third one, dealing with the situation that the widow reduce the amount of the estate, which means havei, we derive from that, Reisha, the second one in the first clause that we brought a proof, Bidelo Ozil, which means the Mishnah meant in the second rule that she, the widow, sold estate for 100 and dinar by the real price in order for her to make sure that she will receive the 100 she entitled with her Ketubah contract the way that the Gemara early explained to us. So therefore, it means that the emissary, the shaliach, he is in a state of ma'avir, which means in a way violated, and not mosif, added. Diktanei seifa, we learn in the last clause. Hayta ketubata 400 zuz. If her marriage contract was in a value of 400 dinars. Now, as you remember, we discussed earlier many times that even in a general rule, betula is 200 and others, almana is 100. It was those days, it was an opportunity to go higher. So, in case that it's 400 zuz, Machra, she divided the estate of her late husband to four different purchasers in order to exercise the her right of the marriage contract. Laze bemane, velaze bemane, which means out of four buyers, the first three, she sold three estates, three fields in their real market value. For example, if it's 400 for our understanding, it's 100 for each estate. However, Vela Acharon, the fourth one, she sold a property, Yafe Mane Vedinar Bemane, something that is worth 101. By less value, which is 100. So what happened here? She had the Ketubah for 400. She sold it for 400. But the difference is the fourth estate worth 101. And the sale was solely for 100. So we said, Shel acharon michra batel. The last sale is void. You think together with me why it's void? Because obviously she sold it below than the market value, even in one. Veshel kulam michran kayam. However, the first three is active sales. So here you see a very big chidush in the Mishnah, something new, which means if the widow selling anything that belongs to the orphan by less than the real value, the sale is void. Which means when the Mishnah said in the last clause, what is yafeh dinar bemaneh v'dinar, v'dinar bemaneh, which is 101, it means that she reduced the price of the estate and she sold it by 100. Here it means that in a way she took care of her ketuba, which is a 400, but Tosfot explains, but in a way the orphan lost one. So there is a book called Beit Yaakov, elaborates on that and said, so think together with me, she have now 400. If we make a big to do, you can ask her to take one dinar and give it to the orphan, right? Why you say that the fourth sale of estate is void? So the answer is, you see the Afla'a and Yoshua, that they're dealing with the idea that we divided the estate. The first three, it's a fair, clear market price. And soon you see it's quote-unquote here. So she have total control to match it by 100. But since the fourth estate was value 101, it means that it's no longer estate that match what is the value of her claim, of her ketubah. So even for the exaggeration, if it was just one more, it's no longer in her power to change the status of the sale. And since it's no longer in her power, therefore we said that the sale is void. So Rav Huna did not accept this claim. And he stick with the explanation earlier, which means from the Mishnah that is no proof, no juxtaposition to our discussion. He said, lo, it's not necessarily the way. Oreisha, the second din, Veseifa, and the third one, de ozil. This apply when he reduced the price of the estate. Veseifa, and the last clause is superfluous. Ha kamash melan, it's come to teach us. Ta ama de ozil beyatmei. The reason that the last sale is void, it's because she, meaning the widow, reduced the value of the estate that belonged to the orphan, meaning she did something in exceeding the price that she deserved in her ketuba. That's the way Rashi explained. He says, after she sold the first three estates, the money that owed by her late husband was only 100 for her ketuba. Since that estate exceeded the 100 that owed to her, so therefore, it's considering a estate that belonged to the orphan. It, for our discussion, is not a her estate. Meaning, the moment she sold that estate, even in one dinar, below than the real value, she caused the estate of the orphan to be in the loss. It means that she didn't follow the interest of the orphan. So therefore, the sale is void. Because, again, as we use that claim again and again, the Yetomim, the orphan, said, letakunei shlachtich, ולא לאבותי. We sent you to ameliorate, to improve the situation, not to deteriorate. In that sense, this estate, indirectly, Rashi said, it's not really yours. So, aval bedida, but when she sell estate that belongs to her, totally her, which means that's applied to what? To the first three estates that sold, micha kayam, her sale is valid. So, by the merely fact, the Mishnah said that the sale is void only by the last one, we derive from that that if she reduced the sale price of the first three estates, it's still valid. Why? Because we said that the first three is total her in payment of her ketuba, of her marriage contract. So therefore, if there is a reduction of the price, she can carry that. It's nothing to do with the orphan. But since the orphan is not losing anything from that sale of the first three, so it's not considering ivut, it's not considering any manner of deterioration of the her call, her mission, so therefore that sales is in effect. We have to remember what we said many times. When it's come to estate, ein ona'a bekarkaot, we follow the rules. When it's come to estate, is no such a thing cheating or misleading, because we said many times, when it's come to estate, is a matter of evaluation, is a matter of what people evaluate the estate, and it can be varied. But the metaltelin, the movable object, again, you can avoid the sale if it was below than 1/6 from the real price. That Gemara in Bava Metzia 50b. Here the mistake was 1 dinar, which means 1 of 100 from the price. So here what do you see? The second rule in the Mishnah that said that she sold something for 100 and 101, it means the same as the last clause, that she reduced the price, and we need both. We need the second one to say that she, if she reduced the estate that belongs to the orphan, even in 1 dinar, is no longer effective sale, is void. But the last part of the Bava, we learn that if she reduced something from her estate, such as the first three estates, the sale is effective, is correct. Ha midereisha shamat mina, we derive from the first clause of the Mishnah that we learn a widow hayta ketubata matayim umachra shaveh maneh, if her marriage contract was 200 and she sold from the estate of the late husband 100 b'matayim, for 200, or shaveh maneh b'matayim, or something that matched the value b'maneh 100, nitkabla ketubata. So even if you really match the prices, it's not the price of the ketuba, but meaning, or if the sale of the estate was less than its value, it's still effective sale, which means she can take the loss, which means since it's the value of 200 that she deserved for her ketuba, so it's good. So why the Mishnah needs to repeat on the last clause, Mao de Teima, Ravuna respond, without the last clause, Ha tamhu de istalka mehai beita legamrei, over there she no longer has anything to do with her husband's estate, as her entire claim has been paid off. Avalacha, in our situation, in the last clause, which is in the three estates of sale, the amount that all is not complete, nigzor maneh rishon atu maneh acharon. We may put a decree for the first sale for 100 dinars will be void to the last one 100 now, which means if you allow the first one, so it may lead to a mistake that the sale will take effect as well. So you have to say that the first sale should be void if she reduced the price. So they said that therefore, kamash melan, so the Tana need to teach us in the last clause that you do not have this type of decree. So according to Ravuna, the big chidush is the first part of the Mishnah. It means that she sell a estate that belongs to her and it's effective sale. Even she reduced the price, she can take the loss. You treat it as she get the real value of the estate in matching her ketubah. The second one, it means if she reduced something that belonged to the orphan. And the third one was that she reduced a state of her is not abrogated the sale, even you can, it can lead to an error and think that the same apply with the state of the orphan, which means that we can go by the second rule of the Mishnah. If she reduces the amount of the estate, and therefore, when we juxtapose the first question of an emissary that sold something more than the ask, you remember 15 and 30, we did not reconcile it. So, there is a book called Ketuvot HaMishpat, and there is another book called Maharit Engel. Maharit Engel was a student of Ketzot HaChoshen. So they disputed over the following case based on this Gemara. Reuven sent Shimon to sell a movable object. And Shimon sold it in a different value. If even it's a one dinar, whatever it is, less, the question is, can the entire sale is void or not? If you tell me that he sell for less, so you hold that he is responsible. That's the way that he would hold, but the Maharit disputed and he said, you know what, you have to go by the market value. Imagine if you sell someone, you send someone to the market to sell you merchandise, and the market turned to be in a different price, and you basically told him, this is my price. Takes, for example, you send someone to sell your car in the auction, and you said, this is my bottom line, this is how much I want to sell the price. And he turns, when he get to that auction, he realize that the prices are totally different, right? So how far responsibility? The same, you can hold the same as mazik and izak. If someone damage, someone else unintentional damage, you requested him to pay the value of the damage, but nothing more. So the ikar de amrei haloti ba'elach, heicha de amar lezil zabin li litcha vezabin li kora. The vaday mosif al dvarav, that for sure he adds more. So therefore, he is certainly adding to the employer's word, and the sale of the first half kor is valid, right? Because you said that. And that's the halacha. The Rambam in Ilchot Shluchim, chapter 1, said that it's a valid sale. You have in the code, Ilchot Alva'a, a big discussion over Shlichut, of sending someone. When and where and how it's effective or not. For example, you have a loan between Reuven and Shimon, and Reuven lost the promissory note. So Shimon said, all right, can reduce a new one. The problem is, Shimon said, wait a second, I'll not sign up for the second document. You know why? Because I'm afraid that you recollect twice. So therefore, the question is, Reuven said, look, the time of the collection is long from now. It's a couple of months from now. And I want to make sure if you're not around or for anything, to have the promissory note. I lost it. Shimon said, it's not my fault that you lost it. Reuven said, so how will I be able to collect if I lost the document and you're not around? Shimon said, it's not my problem. I signed the original one. What do you do? Based on this. Kiti Bayelach, the Amarle Zil Zabenli Korah, he asked him to sell 30, that's the other way around. Ve'azil ve'zaben ve'litcha. He sold 15. My. So now he sold less. Mi amrinan amar li de tavalach avdelach. Come on, I did you a favor. De ilo mitzter chizuze lo matze adar bey. Guess what? If I give you too much cash, what happened with the cash? It's evaporate. One of the problems people have when they're selling estate, sometimes they're thinking to buy another estate they couldn't find. They thought about something, didn't come true. Meanwhile, they sold the other estate. They have a lot of cash. And the cash is what? Evaporate, you know? It's enough to give a credit card to your spouse and to send that person to the mall. So they said, O Dilma, or you may said, אמר לי לא ניחה לי דליפשו שטראי אילב אי. He said, I don't want to have the reputation of someone who keeps selling. You see, especially in the closed community, what happens is when someone is suddenly selling. What do people think? That he's in a bankruptcy or breaching bankruptcy. Because that's not a manner of which people sell. If you see someone is selling everything and anything, for sure you think that he is, and he's not moving out, you know that he's in a financial crisis, right? So, therefore, you hold that the sale is total void. In general, there is a very heavy discussion among the contemporary rabbi, what is geder shaliach, what is the real total definition of emissary. Typical case, you have a big factory and you have a manager of one of the department, and that manager in charge, how do you call it, someone who's in charge for the buying for the company, buying department, is that correct to say? Okay. So this person is not the owner, but he is the appointee buyer. He is in charge of the purchase department. He works many years, and he works directly with different companies, right? Guess what happened? Risk management. You know what happened? The guy was fired. As an act of vengeance, you know, paying back to the owner, he kept buying things, which means that time period between he left, he bought a lot of stuff that wasn't needed, he bought a lot of things disappear, etc., etc. Many months passed by, and suddenly the provider, the company, that the vendor, comes to schedule an appointment with the owner, and he said, look, you know, you owe me here. He says, no, I have a new buyer department manager, and it's a different, and we have other vendors. He says, look, this is what I gave you. And it turns that buyer department manager, he makes all those decisions. So the guy said, look, I kept working with him. I didn't know he's not no longer works for you. You better tell me that he didn't work for you. And the owner of the company said, what do you mean? Every time I fire somebody, I need to pick up the phone and tell everybody that I fire someone. So what do you do? So it's a discussion among the contemporary rabbis. One of the well-known response on how to handle this. Anyway, Amar Rabbi Chanina Misura Tashma. The response to this question from the following Mishnah, which is in a Tractate Me'ilah at the end of 21. Natan lo dinar shel zahav. If he gave him dinar that made out of gold, which is the value of 6 sla'im, ve'amar lo haveli chaluk, and he asked in exchange to have him bringing what? Robe. והלך והביא לו בשלוש חלוק, בשלוש חלוק ובשלוש בשלוש חלוק ובשלוש תלית שניהם מעלו. So he went and he brought him a robe that cost 3 sela and the cloak that also 3 sela. So is both are guilty for what? Misusing consecrated property. He amarad bishlama shaliach ki agav na usay shlichuto. If you tell me the agent did a indirect violation of what he asked, so you have here a situation that he was adding to the word of the employer. Umosiv al dvarav avi is it's basically he did add to the word of the employer. Mishum achi ba'al habayit ma'al. And therefore, the homeowner is guilty of misusing consecrated property. Ele amarat mavir advarav avi. But if you tell me that he is disregarding his word, amai ma'al, why is guilty of misuse consecrated property? So, Tosfot said, the reason that he used a robe, it's not less than 2 shtarot, but anyway, it's considering a shlichut. Hachav ma'askinan de'aitelei shaveshesh b'shalosh. Here we're dealing with a case where they bought him a robe that worth 6 sela for only 3. Yachei shaliach amay ma'al. So if that's the case, why the agent is guilty of misusing consecrated property? Tosfot said that the homeowner most probably agreed that he buying cheap, including that talit. So they said, a talit is for the cloak by the rest of the 3 sla'im. So that's for himself and not by asking a permission from the owner. And therefore, it's considering in reality a misuse. So Yachei, if he bought for his owner a cloak that worth 6 by 3, hey, Maseifa, look at the last clause of the Mishnah. Rabbi Yehuda omer af baze, ba'al habayit lomar, mipnei sheyachol lomar chaluk gadol, hayiti mivakesh ota, hebet li chaluk katan vera. I ask you to bring something, large robe, and you brought me small and bad. So if he brought him, the agent brought him a robe that worth a 6 sela, the way he requested, it should be not bad, the robe. Myra, what does that mean using the word rabed? It means rabed, I mean the value in the monetary is less than what he asked, because he asked him 6. The amarli yaitele bishi kol shiken davale shavet tarte yisrei. He said to him, if you brought me a robe that for 6 sela, I'll have more, so have been worth 12 sela. It will be much finer robe. So it means the emissary, the shaliach, misuse another honor. Daikaname diktane. Moder Rabbi Yehuda bekitnit. Rabbi Yehuda agreed that both are guilty for misusing a consecrated property if you have a case of legumes which is sold for a set price under all the circumstances. Sheshneim malu, that they both are guilty for misusing consecrated property. So it's derivative from here, a very heavy discussion among the contemporary poskim. You send someone, a friend of yours, go to, for example, to Hong Kong, to Japan. And it's 5 people ask that person to buy things from them, a special price, etc., etc. So the person goes and shop and get the better prices and go between stores. He find one store that he can get anything and everything. The all five people ask him for excellent price, beautiful. So the owner of the store give him a big tip, give him something very valuable. Now the question is, that tip belong to whom? Belongs to the group of people that gave him money to buy for them, the five people? Is that belongs to the one who negotiated, the buyer itself? Or you said that you should divide it between all the buyers, or divide it between the buyers and him? He claimed, I made negotiation, I ran around, I did all of that, and I get it from a specific store as a result of a big deal I did. The buyer said, all of that is using our money, so since it's using our money, it's ours. 99, which means when you have this legume for sela and legumes for prita, so he said here, that's the way you properly interpreted the Mishnah. What do you mean? What type of circumstance you are speaking here? If you tell me the place that they appraise this the seller of legume by a special appraisal, so if he give the value of the seller by payment, the seller reduce the price for him more than he had brought less. So it means the buyer profits, and it's clear that even legumes do not have a fixed price. It's a place that they measure the vessels, the case where the merchant said, "Damale kana kana bifruta." He said that fill each vessel in pruta. That's, if you remember, the old merchant, the whole market, that's the way they sell in those vessels. So it means the buyer gets something that is really matched to what he paid, and is not pay less in the back. Tashma etaktu batarba meod zuz. So now we derive the question of the Mishnah. If she have a ketubah of 400 zuz, machala zemane bela zemane, and she sold this one for 100, the other one 400, which means the first three estates she sold the real value. Velacharon yafe midmane v'dinar b'mane, and the last one, as we explained, is 100. And one dinar less, shel achron batel, shel kulam mechan kayam. The last one is void, and all the rest, the sale is valid, because it was the correct price. So the widow was appointed as an agent to sell certain property, and that means in a value of 400 dinar. In reality, she sold only 100 dinar, and nevertheless, it's okay. So the Mishnah doesn't say that she did not do what they often ask her to do. So here you talk about small estate that you have in a geographic way. They are in different location, so you don't have the option but to sell it as a single unit. So here too we talk about situations. So the first three sales, she fulfilled her mission clearly and good. So therefore you don't have a proof to our question. Pshita. Amar le'echad ve'lo le'shnayim. If someone said to his shaliach, to him, emissary, sell one and not two, and then he sold to two, so it means that both of them is void. Amar le'echad ve'lo le'shnayim. So he said that he is very scrupulous that not to add more permissory in order to sell. Amar le'echad stama, my. But if he didn't say specifically, he said just one person, he didn't say more, and he went ahead and he sold it to two people. So it means that it's already a retroactive declaration that it's not an effective one or not. So Ravuna amar le'echad ve'lo le'shnayim. Ravuna said, he said clearly that it's one and not to two. Rav Chisda v'Rav Baravunam d'amrei le'echad v'afilu le'shnayim le'echad v'afilu le'mea. So by them it makes no difference. You can sell the one, Ritva explained, you can sell the two, even the 100, whatever it is, whatever you need, sell. Ikla Rav Nachman le'sura ul gabei Rav Chisda v'Rav Baravunam ulei ki'ai gavna. So what do you do in this deal? Let someone sell to sell it to one. אמר לאחד ואפילו אמר לו לאחד ואפילו לשניים לאחד ואפילו למאה אמרו לי אבל גם דתאה שליח so even he sold the estate for less אמר לו רב נחמן רספונד דתאה שליח לא קאמינה which means if the emissary the agent make a mistake so then the sale is void אמרו לי ואמר מה אין עונה לקרקעות He said, you told us in Tractate Baba Metzia, page 56, that when there's no prohibition against fraud in the sale of land, and land does not have a set value. Sigmar said, Rav Nachman responded, he said, Hane milei, you mean to say that that's applicable leicha de ta'a ba'al ha'bayit, if the owner make a mistake. Aval ta'a shaliach, but if agent made a mistake when he sell the estate of his owner, He said, then the sale is void. אמר לי, לתקון השתרתיך ולא לעבוד. The same story. I send you for my benefit and not to deteriorate the sale. So he's appointed as an agent, is nullified. ומנה, תמר דשני, בן שליח לבעל הבית. How do you know it's the difference between the agent and the owner? For famous Mishna, Tractate Trumot, chapter 4, Mishna 4, דתנן. אומר לשלוחות סאו טרום, he said to his agent, go and give contribution for my produce, but it doesn't say that it is for the purpose of teruma. Torem ke dad bala bayit, he sell the way that the bala bayit expecting. If he doesn't know what's the view of the owner, torem bebeinonit, echad mechamishim. Pichet ma'asara osit ma'asara terumato tmura, if he less than 10, it's still considering teruma. Ve'ilu legabei bala bayit, נתניה תרם ועלה בידו אפילו אחד מ-20 תרומתו תרומה so he said that even if someone is a bala bai the homeowner himself we learned that if he separate to mine even 1/20 of the produce came up to his hand his donation is affecting and considering tuma so it means that the agent may deviate from the intention of the homeowner only within the certain parameters not always tashma הייתה כתובת 400 זוד, מחל לזה מנה ולזה מנה. So he back to our subject that she sold the estate of the first three in the real value. ולאחרון יפה מנהר ודינר במנה, which means the last one was 101, שלאחרון בטלו שכולם חן כאן. As we said, the last sale is void, but the rest is okay, which means that she is the emissary of the orphan to sell up to 400 zoos from the estate in exchange of her ketubah. So therefore the first three sale is effective even she sold it several times instead of selling it one time which means that the person doesn't care if you sell it to one or you sell it to more than one אמר רב שיש אברידי רבידי בקטינה no רב שיש אברידי said that that's not a good example because he would talk about small tracts of land that are geographically separate and do not from one land mass that can be sold as a single unit So therefore, that's a different case. You cannot compare to others. So there's the whole discussion of Poskim based on this sugya, the issue of lottery ticket. As we said, if Reuven sent Shimon and he said to him, buy for me a ticket for $10, but he didn't give him the money. He just asked him to buy. And Shimon bought a ticket by his own money. The big argument is, how you go about to if Shimon refuse to use that income from that ticket if it's win to pay Reuven what do you said it's belong to Shimon since he bought in his money no you said it's belong to Reuven because Shimon claimed that if it didn't make money you come back with the ticket and I'll pay you the value and that's the reason why I sent you to right or you said you should split it that's part based on this sugya
ויחם לשולוים מלאכי ישולוים מלאכי